This is the SF Productions Podcast Network.
Good evening and welcome to another exciting episode of Vast Wasteland.
Could it be Bob Denver, Karen Valentine, Walt, the cast of Soap, Henry Winkler, Mr. Ed and Wilbur, Marty J. Wiley, Mark Schmidbauer, and in the center square, Wilbert Neal. All on the new
Tuesday at 6, Wednesday the 10, Thursday at 3. At Darren Pamela Ferdin. Oh no, not another Burgess Meredith show.
Welcome to the place your parents didn't understand.
The world of 60s and 70s television.
Welcome to Vast Wasteland.
Welcome home.
Wasteland, the video journal of 60s and 70s television. I'm your host, Mark Schmidbauer, along with Wilbert Neal and Marty Wiley. Well, tonight we're going to talk about shows that just didn't seem to make any sense.
Like this one?
Yeah, other shows, other than this one.
Well, see, we don't make any sense because we don't get paid.
But you know.
Bad puns. They're us.
So,
or at least me.
Yeah, some shows, they went on for a long time, and some shows, they just didn't make it at all, but they all were dumb concepts for shows, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. But before we get into the big extravaganza of fun, just want to tell you we're on Tuesdays at 6, Wednesdays at 10, and Thursdays at 3 p.m. here on ACTV Cable 21. That's right. Also, if you want to write into Vast Wasteland, you want to write Box 15, 14, 11, Columbus,
11.
Ohio, 43215.
43215. Echo Man.
Well, anyways, on to tonight's topic, dumb concepts for shows.
Besides this one.
Yeah, other dumb concepts for shows.
Okay.
Well, see, this is a very intelligent concept for a show because it had never been, like, done before, you know?
Yeah,
dumb concepts are things that, like, people would wake up at, like, 2 in the morning and they just say, hey,
this
hasn't been done before. Let's do this.
Isn't this a new character?
And this one was caught up in, a drunken stupor, so it's like,
right.
Okay.
Well, the first one, you really can't talk about dumb concepts for shows where you talk about the king of dumb concepts, Gilligan's Island.
Indeed.
That's right.
That was actually, like, somebody view of like a sociological view if you got these certain types of
That's
people
right.
together and stranded them. So
That's
it was
right.
like they were trying to be deep.
Oh, is that it? I don't think so.
Hey, somebody's put an awful lot of thought into
yeah.
that.
Way too much.
Yeah.
But it's
they
true,
thought
though.
About it too much, but it's true. It's like they thought they were going to be like deep with it.
It went real deep.
What? Yeah, if you stranded like rich people and poor people and like movie star people and like a smart guy.
The smart guy. And then just the average farm girl next door.
Now, one thing that always bugged me was the first, I don't know if it was the first season or first couple seasons, that you really had, if you were Marianne or the professor, you really had to be mad. Because if you remember the opening there, the opening theme was like, President, you know, it's like,
Gilligan
and his wife, the movie star,
and the rest.
Like, there's yeah. a whole bunch
there
more.
There are so many more, we can't tell you all of them.
We just cannot think of a way to make these names rhyme.
And yet, eventually, they find one.
The professor and Marianne.
You know what their fatal mistake was?
What's that?
Nobody ever read Lord of the Flies. Gilligan's Island could have been like a two-part
right.
miniseries.
Yeah. Yeah, that well, really skipper, grisly ending.
If the skipper had worn glasses, it would yeah. have just been all over.
Gilligan's head on a pole.
That's right.
It.
Well, you see,
ooh, those bizarre William Golding references. Read this book at your public library.
Read more about it.
You mean the educational system has gone to hell so much you don't have to read Lord of the Flies in your sophomore year?
I never read
school?
It.
No, I had
oh,
to.
Oh, man, I had to.
Of course, I did see the movie, and I haven't seen the new one yet. But
I did see the movie.
But I didn't see that until I was already out of school, so hey, well, there
you go. That doesn't count.
So
had to at least read the Cliff Notes like I did.
I heard a lot about it.
Now, the deal is, you have a show with these people and their shipwreck, and you know the whole deal. But almost immediately they realize, wow, this is really a limited concept. And there's almost going to have to be some almost quasi-drama after a while, you know? Because they don't have anything. So, all of a sudden, boom, they've got stuff.
Well, the professor
brought everything he could.
He was working overtime. The professor is actually like MacGyver's father or somebody. You know? he could just look in the sky and whip up a cloudy day. You know?
Take two coconuts and make a radio.
He just pulls out a gum wrapper and instantly he's got a phone. You know?
Coconuts, no problem. Make a nuclear reactor, no problem.
That professor,
well, a lot
what
of
a guy.
Stuff like washed up and they like.
Well, that was the other thing. They also realized that only seven characters, pretty much, they're all stereotypes. And so
the only way to make anything happen, you're going to have to introduce new items, new characters, new concepts.
To this uncharted desert isle.
Exactly.
And yet, every week, boom, here's another guy. Here's the astronauts. Here's the aliens.
Here's the natives from the other island.
Yeah.
The island across the street.
Yeah, pretty much.
Here's the volcano that erupts. Here's the crate of, what was that, the plastique that floats up.
Oh, yeah.
They make the dishes and the monkey can throw them and blow them all up.
It is, Kip.
And Gilligan had the filling.
Yeah.
Don't bite down, little buddy.
Ooh. What? Oh, yeah. Now, while you had the people who had lots of changes of clothing, you had Ginger with all the gowns, and you had Marianne that was at one point changed outfits,
mm-hmm.
And of course the Howells had all bunch of stuff.
Oh yeah.
But then you've got the Skipper, Gilligan, and Professor. What I want to know is, did the professor like whip up some sort of super detergent that didn't wear away these clothes? They had one set of clothes.
Well, actually,
they wore them every day.
Actually, the professor had several sets, but they were all the same thing.
Yeah, like Einstein. He always wanted to have
Skipper
the same.
Were like men of the sea. They were not used to changing their clothes.
Ooh, yikes. That's really.
That's how come they shared
nobody else wanted them.
They shared that in their hut.
Now, the thing is that while this show went on, they decided later, the same producer, Sherwood Schwartz, later, of course, to do Brady Bunch, decided, darn it, this whole Gilligan's Island deal, we have not beaten this into the ground. So they slapped together a syndicated show called Dusty's Trail.
Oh, yeah!
Now, this was, what, 73? And you had Bob Denver as Dusty. And then you had, you know, like the Wagon Master and the Rich Socialites, you know. It was like two Rich Socialites, Sassy Lulu and Sweet Young Betsy, and the Nice Young Man. So pretty much the exact same concept, but it's in the Wild Wild West, and they're going across the dusty trail. Really stunning, they thought that this idea that nobody would notice that this was the exact same show.
I don't think I did.
Oh, no. I found the same kind of thing with Land of the Giants.
Yeah.
Where basically you have your captain, you have your co-captain, you have another guy, and still yet another guy, and here's the stewardess, and here's another lady on board. Damn. Commander Fitzhugh, who's like, he was rich until all his money blew
right.
away. Because
kind
the, big,
of a combination
the
of
giant
Dr.
cat
Howell
scared him.
Dr. Smith. Kind
of. And you have the kid.
Yeah.
But basically, I kind of looked at this and I thought, well, gee, Irwin, this is a kind of a silly concept. Because what do you have here? You have people that are taking a voyage, not the three-hour tour. they're flying over the Atlantic. They're flying to London in their the mini shuttle kind of thing. It's the subspace. Supersonic transport kind of deal.
They thought up a Concorde.
Right.
And, okay, they're flying along. You introduce the catalyst, which is the mysterious green cloud that they fly through. Which wouldn't that be related to, isn't there something about cows over in Europe that are causing the depletion of the ozone layer or something like
that? Cows in general.
Okay, cows in general. Couldn't that be what this, well, cow gases, wherever they may come from.
I don't think they make a green cloud, though. I think
now the green cloud is like a synonymous thing for the gas
what
kind
are you
of.
On?
Yeah, what are you going for here with this?
Anyway, there's this green cloud that these things are flying through, and it has the interesting effect of shrinking these people, which I find very scary. But anyway.
So you think the shuttle astronauts should beware?
No, they're outside of the atmosphere. No, they're okay.
Send those guys up, they'll come back. They'll go through a green cloud. A cow gas, and they'll shrink. Okay.
Wow, this is a scary cut. But anyway,
you need another week's vacation.
But that whole green cloud thing, that's like the silly part of the thing. And the fact that once they were shrunk, did they stay the same size? No, they didn't. We've talked about this before. They would grow, they would shrink. They would still be smaller than whatever were the large people that were there. But yet, sometimes this book would probably be, about this size to them. And next time, it would be like the size of a building.
Right.
Some days they can pick up a pencil to dial a phone, and the next day the pencil is just huge, just like a giant redwood tree to them. So, silly concept.
I think I can disagree with you about Gilligan's Island being a king of stupid shows.
Yeah.
My mother, the car.
Oh,
that's
yeah,
the
there,
king
you go,
of stupid
there you go.
Shows.
That's
that
right.
That is the epitome of the stupid idea.
I mean, come on, I bought a car. My mother's voice came out the radio. That car will be gone. Excuse me, Mom, click. Car
My car
for sale.
Is possessed.
Cheap.
Didn't they do that same, wasn't Christine kind of?
No.
Idea of a possessed car.
Was possessed. No, this was just stupid.
And that's by the spirit of Ann Southern. That's the worst part of it.
But I don't think that was her fault.
Yeah.
I really don't think that was her fault.
No.
I thought somebody, like, got her drunk and told her it was a good idea, and she's like, yeah, okay, I'll sign.
Well, they had to think of, it's like she was on a contract or something, that she had to do another
right.
show, obviously,
right.
and so they were saying, well, wait a minute, now, I've got it, we'll use your voice. That way, you don't really have to be there, but yet you'll get credit for it, and you'll be fulfilling your contract. Let's
right.
do that.
Yeah.
But that was, how many people would keep a car that was talking to them like that?
Well, if she tells him, watch where you're going. Don't stop here. What are you going here for? Isn't this one of those girly places? Get away from here.
You're driving too fast.
We'd be driving out and dealing with that car. Here, $2, $2, $2, no.
Trade this one off.
That's right.
That's another stupid concept.
Another really silly concept for a show, and they've done this a lot, is take a bunch of, like, today they would do stand-up comedians, but then it was like vaudeville-ish, Catskill-ish type comedians. Throw them all together in a show, and you get Car 54, Where Are You?
She's coming back somewhere.
A movie. There's going to be a movie. The Car 54 movie is actually in production, or it was done, or something. It's coming out real soon.
The Comedy Central channel, like, is going to start showing it.
Well, showing the original ones?
Yeah. Well, that was a funny
show. Well, they
show.
Were showing them for a while.
Nick at Night
somebody was showing them.
Nick at Night
or somebody
them for
showing
a long
them.
Time. I think they still are every once in a while.
I don't know. I don't look at the numbers. I just change the channel.
And one thing I was reading about this was that that the car they used, because they shot mostly in New York. It was actually shot out of a studio in the Bronx. Uh-huh. So they had a police car, but they couldn't have a real police car, you know, that would be confused with the other police cars. So, since it was all shot in black and white, the police car used in the show was red and white in real life. And so, obviously, not a real police car.
So, let's hope not.
Yeah, well.
There's truth.
So, there you go. Let's see. Another show, which is another concept of... See, there's been thousands of shows that have ripped off other shows.
Oh, yeah.
But, in my opinion... But, in my opinion, one of the first shows to do this, and one of the most blatant ripoffs, is I Married Joan. Starring, according to ABC, was the queen of comedy, Joan Davis. No, that's not in some... This is not some show from a parallel universe or something. You're probably saying, who is Joan Davis? Well...
Queen of comedy.
Yeah. ABC wanted to do a certain show about, you know, with a scatterbrained wife and a normal husband. And with a slight resemblance to a certain show with a redhead and a band leader, but...
I married Joan and look at me.
I married insert name here.
Yeah, exactly. And, of course, Jim Backus was on that show. Yeah. An affinity, actually, for dumb concepts for shows.
It's like he's probably fulfilling his contract, too.
Right. Probably.
Maybe he was fulfilling a dream.
Now, I looked at a couple of shows here and thought, now, this is like, now, one was enough, but then you take the idea and you reverse it, and then you've got the other one, and they were both made by the same company, basically. I'm looking here at the Beverly Hillbillies and Green Acres.
Yep.
You great think, shows.
Well, but, I don't know, kind of a silly concept. It's like the extreme
of
a concept. It's like, well, you've got people that move from the country to the city, you know, but this is like the extreme country moving to the extreme city under an extreme circumstance. Although I guess there's people winning the lottery and moving in different neighborhoods or things, but it's not like you're moving from the hills to Beverly Hills, you know.
Just hit that lottery and move to Bexley.
And then you got the same thing here with Green Acres, where he's got all the money,
but he's
upset with the whole idea, so he moves from the city to the country.
No, wait a minute, that was like a really 60s thing to do.
Well, yeah, but we're not looking at... This is like an extreme of the idea.
Oliver was just taken up with that whole 60s mood, you know?
This is true. This is true, but it's in Green Acres.
Oh, not green again. Shut up. Because of the cows?
No, not at all.
Wait a minute.
It's just like you took the idea of one and then you reversed it for the other one. And so it was, I don't know. I just looked at it as being kind of sillier.
Well, I was going to say, a show that's really kind of a footnote in television history. One idea is to take two ideas and slap them together, and we'll say we'll make a whole hybrid type show. Frontier Circus. This was the 61 to 62.
Okay.
We had the Western concept, you know, and you had these two guys running this circus, and they're both kind of like Route 66 type guys, you know, the two guys roaming the country and helping people, and they happen to run a circus.
these are like too
many ideas. Just got rammed them together.
Well, please, Dad, and the kids.
So you got circus acts for the kids.
Not to mention Mom.
Yeah. You got hunky guys for the gals. and for the guys you had a Western. There you go.
There you go.
You've got every single demographic in
family
one show.
The family show. The ultimate family show.
I just thought that was really idiotic. But
I looked at another one here that was kind of a silly concept. Where you've got a group of people who are suddenly displaced from their natural surroundings, and so what do they decide to do? They decide to move to another place to get these people to help them to regain whatever was their own natural surroundings. I'm talking basically here about Battlestar Galactica. Where you've got an advanced, a really truly advanced group of people who decide that it's time to end their big war with this group of robots. And so they're going to have this great big peace treaty thing, and they're sending out their most trusted member of their delegation, who turned out to be a big traitor anyway, to send out this peace treaty, and it's really just a big ploy to let the robots overthrow them. So the robots come in, and they blow up, like, everything. This sounds like pretty much an Irwin Allen kind of stuff. Anyway,
yeah.
And then it retraces Gene Roddenberry's idea of the wagon train to the stars, because they pull together everything that's left, and they're going to travel off to find the lost colony, Earth.
Right.
Well, and it would have been fine if, when they got to Earth, which they didn't really do until Battlestar 1980 or whatever.
Right. Galactica 1980.
That if it would have been fine, if it would have been a futuristic Earth, that could have made a possible difference, could have helped them. But no, they get to, like, contemporary modern, present day Earth.
Because they suddenly realize, we still got all these props from the show, but we don't have to want to make more futuristic props. We want to do it present day, so it's cheap.
Exactly. And so then they just run into a great big problem there.
Right.
But I don't know, just kind of a silly idea. I liked the show, but it was kind of just a silly idea.
Well, now, a show that you were going to, you were talking about time, and I assumed you were going to go into It's About Time.
It's about time, it's about space, it's about time to slap your face.
There's an idea that really could have worked a lot better than they actually did it. Guys, going through, astronauts, they go up, and somehow they go through time. Now, you can have an interesting, like a comedic concept. Every time, every week they're going to a different time, wacky things happen. You know, you could work something out. No. We're going to take them to the prehistoric past where they find...
This time we're going to go back. Way back.
Joey Ross and
Back into time.
they find Gunther Tootie.
The only people that existed were troglodytes.
And Imogene Coca. That's what they find. And about halfway through the season, they realize this isn't going to work. So
it's costing too much, basically.
So they reverse the concept. The guys figure out how to fix their spacecraft, and they take the
cave people
back to present time. And now, it's the wacky situation in the cavemen in the present time. Again, an incredibly limited concept. How they thought they would ever go on for years and years is absolutely beyond me.
And yet they've done it again and again.
Right.
In movies or whatever, you take somebody from the past and you bring them into whatever is the contemporary modern day world to see how they'll react.
Okay, ultimate stupid variety show, since I know Mark loves variety shows.
Right.
Pink Lady and Jack.
Yeah, we've talked about this so many times.
But
I really,
yet it
I almost didn't want to
talk about
it
again.
Yeah.
Let's take two people that can't speak a word of English. And let's give them a show in America.
What a horrible concept.
With a comedian.
With a comedian.
Right.
Who's actually more appreciated in Britain than his own country.
Well, hey, they were using this as the big vehicle that would make him appreciated in America.
Oops.
Maybe not.
Oops.
Well, if you're talking about that whole period of time, the late 70s, you can't go by dumb concepts for shows without talking about Super Train. Super Train. Yeah, it's like, we want to rip off Love Boat, but we have to have a different concept. So we'll put it on a train. We won't just put it on a train. We'll put it on an enormous nuclear-powered train that goes across the country at almost aircraft-type speeds.
Works for me. Get a lot done.
It goes so fast, you get there yesterday.
That's right. And so it's so obviously a Love Boat ripoff. And just stunning. And this show cost millions and millions of dollars, and NBC lost millions on it, and it's a ripoff of another show. If they were going to rip something off, do it cheap.
The Love Canoe.
Something. It could have been a regular train. It didn't have to be a nuclear powered train.
No, they were trying to cash in on the big science fiction. Science fiction is always always a
oh geez.
Hey, always a something. You could have got a lot of action.
Oh my. Well, and one more show was this is another of this Western concept, and this I don't know, this is Pistols and Petticoats.
Oh,
66,
yeah.
67. Let's see, it's Western situation comedy told the story of the Hanks family, three generations strong. Despite their respective ages and sex, all members of the Hanks family, with the exception of blah, 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 were remarkably adept with guns.
Yeah,
and the wackiness ensues from there. It's wacky. Yikes. How they thought this was going to work.
Everybody's got a gun.
Let the wackiness begin.
What a family. The family.
The hijinks.
Together.
Yeah.
Stays together.
Hijinks. Hijinks and hilarity all over.
Yeah. At least they had a hobby.
And then I guess as my final show with a wacky concept, you're lost in space.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, pretty much. Yep.
Another Irwin Allen
you
kind of thing.
You wouldn't think that was funny? That poor Russian cosmonaut guy that just got down last week.
Right.
Well, it's not like he was lost in space. He was just stranded in space.
Wouldn't it be awful, though, if you're up there and that's the only thing you could pick up on your space TV? Turn it on. Oh, man.
Lost in space and reruns of Maroon. Yeah, there. That's a real confidence builder. That'd work.
Yeah, let's
and,
it,
and then you and then you're Russian, so you can't understand what they're saying.
Right.
Let's get real. I would have kicked Dr. Smith off the first planet we landed.
Okay.
Shut up. We can work the robot.
I was like, yeah, they pretty much figured out how to work the robot, and he just complained the whole time.
Oh, yeah. I would have ditched him out a window.
I don't know.
Over here, Dr. Smith, look
how,
there.
How
look
far
there.
Out of control could this ship have gone? Didn't
right.
Didn't they train before
right.
they went
you
up?
Know, they had some idea. Wait, if you got to assume if Don had ever really taken command, Dr. Smith, he's a ghost. He's
that's
a vapor.
Right.
We're going to take off. We're going to shoot him out one of the ejection tubes. He's done.
Oh, we're going to shoot him out of an ejection tube in a minute.
Just turn his quarters into a vacuum.
Well, anyways, we're being given the signal that it's about time to get out of here.
We just scraped the tip of the iceberg.
That's right.
Stupid shows.
Because there are just so many of them.
I think basically you can look at almost any show that's on TV and look at make something stupid about it. I think
that's what makes television great.
What makes television great is the fact that you just keep watching.
Now who's stupid?
Well, next time on Vast Wasteland, we're going to be talking about Disney, the whole Disney universe, Wonder World of Disney, cartoons, everything. For all of us here at Vast Wasteland, we'll see you next time. Goodbye, everybody!